Somehow I woke up out in Beverly, fucked up, smelling like that bourbon. And I end up alone, I'm not certain. Yeah, the girls impolite in the club every night. That's how it goes when you Hollywood person.
Welcome people, Lumini here, back in with another episode of Sunderland Save here on my channel. As you can see, we are starting this episode off with the time where Derby up against Newcastle. We then take our first steps into the round of 16 of the Europa League and then finish off with a game against Crystal Palace. So two relatively big games. Obviously every game in the league for us at the moment is a pretty big game. We are still in top four at the moment with the teams around us having played, but it's a pretty tight race for those top four spaces, so we definitely have to keep our focus and keep trying to push. This just really bothered me because Bruno Fernandes showing up as a Leeds player is not something that I am ready to see. Obviously, Solé's back. He has lost the rating because of his injury, so he will be starting on the bench. We've got the likes of Carter and Massengo as well. I actually think we're going to bring Carter up to the bench and drop Kozlowski down for this game. I've got to work out who's actually going on the bench and who's not, but yeah, we're going to just hop into the game because our team is pretty much the one that we want to play this game with.
For raw passion, it's hard to beat the northeast of England. And what we have on the menu for you today is appetizing. The Tyne Wear Derby. Sunderland against Newcastle United.
Curse on our Sunderland suits. It's in St. James's Park. Like, we haven't played here before. We've literally played here multiple times already over the last couple of seasons. But yeah, let's take a look at their lineup and see what we're going up against. Got Perrin in goal, Wan-Bissaka, Cole, Wilfred, Fana, Senea, Buena, Kessie and Longstaff in midfield three. Silas, João Pedro, is that the old João Pedro? And Anderson, Danioli, Murphy, couple of players on there that I don't know. Our team is similar to the one that we've used for the last couple. We do a proper fitness on them, so Wan-Bissaka coming through. Oh no, that's poor from me, and that's even worse from Etienne Green once again. Etienne Green just does not deal with the shots that come. Why are we looking at their boots? Interesting celebration animation, not seen that one before. Defending from me, I will say, is admittedly not great. Good back heel from Wan-Bissaka, but that's not a difficult shot to deal with again from Etienne Green. We do go 1-0 down away to Newcastle. He's going to find Sesko on the run. Sesko, man, you've got to start making the goalkeeper work with some of these opportunities, because we are giving you chance after chance to actually get shots away and you are just fluffing your lines every single time right now. Gelhart's going to make the run in behind. Good finish, Joe Gelhart. I had regrets when I hit that there because I thought I should have laid it across to Vertsen, but no. Joe Gelhart still being our attacking influence in this one. Big finish from him to make it 1-1. It's good work from Turam as well to intercept the ball and play it through. It's very tight angle. I saw Vertsen in the middle and I was just scared there because Colwell was hunting us down. I just felt like he was probably going to be able to get across to the ball. Jim Gelhart round Fofana. Sesko, there we go. Finally he finds himself in the right place. Good counter-attack and good work once again from Joe Gelhart. Gets us through on goal and it's an easy lay across. Sesko was not kept with by Levi Colwell. And Wan-Bissaka's behind him as well. I think Colwell just doesn't actually realise that he's there. It's an easy finish for Sesko, so not much to write home about. But it's the goal that gets us in the lead at St. James's Park. So we have to take it, especially because we found ourselves under a bit of pressure just before that. Sangare shows very good physicality there to take the ball. Gelhart finds Sesko again. Oh, Benjamin. Well, they've not given Wan-Bissaka a lot of options to throw to here. good tackle from Sessegnon. We will go into half-time with a 2-1 lead. I'll be honest, I'm not overly thrilled with our performance. We've been just better than Newcastle, but still a lot of improvement to be had from us in the second half.
Alex Scott will tell us all about it.
Oh, good ball from Sesko. Bertson's on. Can he finish? Yes, he can. We're going to make it 3-1 very early on in the second half. We catch Newcastle on a quick break. It's good ball from Sesko there. Like I said, he's been underwhelming in the first half besides from the goal that he scored. But it's a good ball through.
This is counter-attacking football.
Good touch from Jörg Bertson to get out of his feet. And then once again, a good finish one-on-one from Jörg Bertson. He himself has been lacking some of those, but has been better than Sesko still. So getting blocked by Cassie now. João Pedro to Alex. Blocked by Gahey. Anderson back into Alex. That's a very good save by Etienne Green there. Give Etienne Green a lot of shit, especially because I feel like he should be performing at a slightly higher level. But that is a huge one from Etienne Green.
Far from the ideal pass, you've got to say.
Good ball to Bertson. If he can head it down to Sesko, that's a good team goal from us there. And that will make it 4-1 against Newcastle. And maybe even the end of the game against Newcastle, because I can't see them managing to bounce back in this one. But you never know for sure. It's a good ball here from Joe Gellhart to Vertsen. Vertsen does very well to get up for the header. I think Colwell may have just been out of position, so couldn't get across to it. And then Vertsen heads it across to Sesko for his second goal of the game. Sessegnon will stretch his man and find Jörg Bertson. Tight angle, but Jörg Bertson off the inside of the post. 5-1 Sunderland against Newcastle. Newcastle have been handily dealt with, I have to say so myself. Jörg Bertson has had a big performance, and Levi Colwill has had quite a poor performance. Not really managed to stay with Bertson many times in this game. Keep our press up, keep our discipline going. That's a very good ball, to be fair, around the corner. Wan-Bissaka with a very poor ball, though. Umar Soleil would deal with it, and that should be full time. There we go. Time where Derby is ours once again. 5-1 victory over Newcastle. Not really a close game. They did score early, and it looked like they were going to give us a little bit of trouble, but pretty much after they scored, the whole game was ours. So, yeah, well done, well handled. They are picking Joe Gellhart for man of the match. And to be honest, I agree with them. Inform Joe Gellhart. Congratulations, Joe. Let's move on to the next one. All right, here we go, Freiburg. We do have a press conference to do before we do this first leg. So let's get that done. Welcome, everybody. We're ready to get underway whenever you're ready with questions. You take on Freiburg in this round of 16 matchup. Do you think that having faced them twice in your group makes it more difficult or easier for you facing them now? It's, in a way, nice to be facing a team that we've already faced in the Europa League this season. But as you say, it's also, in a way, a bigger risk because obviously Freiburg are going to want to get some sort of retribution over us for taking two wins off of them already. But we have a good pool to look at of information on Freiburg to pull from and to help us train with. We kind of have a gauge of how they're going to play. We can get a gauge of their sort of lineups as well. So we've got a lot of useful information for this matchup against Freiburg. So it has its positives and its negatives, but we're confident and we're looking forward to the match. Now, with only 16 sides left in the competition, who would you say is your favourite to go all the way? There's some big name sides in this competition still. We'd obviously have to throw our own hat in the ring just for the sake of confidence and belief that we have in ourselves. But when you have a team like Real Madrid in this competition still, you always have to look towards a team of that stature as a potential favourite to take it all. Like I said, we want ourselves to be the winners, so we'll always throw our hat in the ring. We'll always say that we can compete on our best day with any side in Europe. But yeah, you never know for sure, but maybe Real Madrid, you would have to say, just based on the stature of the club and its history and the players that they've attracted in the past and the teams that they have, they would probably be considered favourites.
With you fighting on so many fronts in different competitions, do you think your side have what it takes to go all the way in this specific one?
Yeah, look, we've already won some silverware this season. We already have the Carabao Cup to our names in our domestic league. We ideally would like to add another bit of silverware this season. The Europa League is our best opportunity to do so. So we're pushing hard for this competition. It's taken its toll on the team. It's taken its toll on players throughout the season. But we're ready. We're going to push and we're going to do everything we can to take a victory in this first leg and hopefully in this tie overall, and then we're going to push as hard as we can to try and win the whole competition. Thanks, guys. All right, here we go. First leg against Freiburg. Obviously, Freiburg were in our group, so we have played them already. We did beat them both times we played them, but this could be their chance for potentially getting revenge. I'm going to put David Raya in there. This may be a controversial decision to make, but I'm just going to play David Raya at the start of this one. Obviously, he'll play out the whole game, but I want to give him a game. I think we played him in the cup last.
What a mouth-watering prospect this is. Two genuine heavyweights of European football, both with the potential to go all the way.
I don't know.
Difficult to pick a winner here.
I don't know if that's necessarily true, if you can call us two heavyweights of European football. So I'm pretty sure this is only our second time in Europe. Won't know if they've made that many signings, but let's take a look. Flecken in goal, Omari, Papagay, still Sharda there, Rodriguez, Williams, Skip, Sharda, Benete, Rahimi, Dieng. I mean, I think it's a pretty similar team to what we played. Our team's the same as the last game, besides from David Raya coming into the playing goal. But yeah, let's see how we do against Freiburg. Away from home in the first leg. That is not really the start that I want from you, Florenzio.
Can he make a count? Oh,
good save from David Raya early on, being asked questions of straight away. Florenzio Santos there, not really dealing with either threat.
Josh
Brownhill's going to find Sesame. They look as though they want to make this take on Nico Williams. The ball to Brownhill, finds Sesko in the middle. Good save from Flecken. He is a good keeper, we know that for sure. Florenzio Santos with a powerful header, another good save from Flecken, but he didn't do anything with it. We may have to bring Vertsen off as well if he doesn't recover. Oliver Skip for them obviously also has an injury. It's a big volley at the back post there for Sesko, but once again Benjamin Sesko doesn't seem to have his boots on at the moment. It's a tough volley, I'll give him that, but Sangare. What? What's just happened? Now Sangare's gone down injured. Oh my god, stop game. Stop. There's just injuries all over the pitch at the moment. What the fuck? Sangare literally, I don't know what just happened to him. He just folded in half. Like, I was trying to get him. He came in, intercepted the ball, and then just fell over and gave up. That was very strange. I'm going to leave him on for now. But Sangare may also... We're going to come out of this game with two injuries from the looks of things. Again, we're getting closed off so easily there. They are closing down Sesko a lot, which is probably smart, but also very annoying because a lot of our build-up play does tend to go through him. Even if, just because he can hold up the ball a little bit better. That's a good ball this time, though. Sesko can bring it down, and he can finally finish one off. And like I said, I felt like if one goal went in, that could be the winner. So hopefully, my theory will prove to be right and we will walk away 1-0 winners in this one, because it has been a hell of a struggle. Like I said, we've been the better team the whole game pretty much. We've been all over Freiburg, but they have held fast at the back for sure. Kept us out very well. And you know, in this game, it only takes one counter-attack to find a goal if you're the AI. I mean, I am definitely going to look for another, but it may not happen. Sesko brings that down well and finds Sessegnon again. Sesko rolls, and there we go. We do hit a quick two goals. Good work from Sessegnon there. Finds the ball back to Sesko. He holds on to it well. Rolls his man and finishes into the bottom corner. That should be us taking the 2-0 advantage. That's a great camera angle to see absolutely fucking nothing. Should be hopefully us taking a 2-0 advantage to the home leg, which gives us a very good chance of advancing to the next round. Good ball there to Anasuari in the box. Good touch. Oh, good work from Anasuari to get a shot away. For the last couple of minutes, Mark Gahey up for one, hits the crossbar, falls to Kozlowski, falls to Santos. It's falling all over the place, but not into the back of the net. Sorry, tries to volley one. I think that's Anthony Gordon come off the bench there. And we will take the 2-0 advantage into the next leg. Good performance, to be fair. Freiburg made it difficult to break him down, but we did hang on to it. We kept our belief, kept going forward, and eventually we do walk away 2-0 winners in this one. We won't be giving a special card for this leg, obviously. It will be next leg that we give a special card for if we win it, which hopefully we will. As you can see by the stats, we completely dominated the game. Freiburg only having two shots overall. Let's see what these injuries are. 4 weeks for Jorb Vertsen, and that's very annoying. Only 8 days for Ibrahim Sangare, so he will miss the Palace game. But he will be back in time for the next leg against Freiburg. Let's get through these next 2 days, and then we'll get into the game against Palace. Actually, before we do that, I meant to say that in the last, after winning the last game against Newcastle, we went back up into third. And we have the chance against Crystal Palace to open up a good advantage over Chelsea and West Ham. Thomas Drew is available for selection once again. Obviously, we won't be rushing him back in, as we never do. But nice to have him back, especially because now he is a left-sided player. He's a left-back, so we'll be interesting to see how he plays there. Last game of the episode, up against Crystal Palace. They're in 13th, we're in 3rd. We do have to make a couple changes here, though, because obviously we've got tired legs, having only just played. Etienne Green in goal, back for Kabore, Solé, Santos and McCallum. Masengo going into that CDM role, Kozlowski coming into midfield alongside Brownhill. Gelhardt in cam and Zawari and Sesko up top. Zaha's on the bench, as well as Carter and Turam is down there. Let's take a look at the Palace lineup. Butland in goal. Murray, Soyuncuk, Vardiol, and Luke Thomas, the back four. Tobias Decore, Daniel Richards, the midfield three. Rack, Saki, Dolberg, and Bangura. Philip Max, the Frutos. Ebioe was the one that we struggled with when he came off the bench. He's got a couple goals against us. Oh, so Larry did not deal with that. Whoa, that's a good strike from Dolberg, who chipped it up in front of his man. Callum again with a good bit of defending. And the second bit of good defending. Are you kidding me? I swear he touched that. That's poor defending from Josh Brownhill once again. What the hell? Bangura somehow put that wide. We've kind of got that, like, oh, you've changed the team slump a little bit. Ceballos gets blocked. Right. Bangura. Someone's offside, and Bangura missed again. Defensively, we're being very strange. We're kind of letting the ball deflect around quite a lot, which is something that I'm not a big fan of, obviously, because it's leading to chances for our opposition. Issa Kabore here with a good ball from Sesko. Gelhardt puts it top bins. Like I said, we've not been the best, but we take the lead, so we will definitely ride our luck there and take our chance, like we have done so. Look at that kid. I've never noticed a kid that small in the crowd before. What the hell? Good ball to Kabore. Good ball inside to Gelhardt. He brings Soyuncu out, but Soyuncu can't close the angle. And that is a very good finish from Joe Gelhardt, who is becoming one of our most relied upon goal scorers at the moment, with Sesko being a bit in and out on his finishing. Obviously, Sesko is still our top goal scorer. Still far and away the best goal scorer that we have. But Joe Gelhart is definitely starting to make a name for himself. That was a great strike from Kozlowski there, and an amazing save from Butland. Oh, Solé gets ahead to that one, but it just drifts wide. Anna Suari here finds Sam McCallum. And that is a great little ball inside from Sam McCallum to find Benjamin Sesko, who volleys home at the near post. Like I said, we've been riding our luck a little bit. We've taken control of the game late on into the first half here, but we've riding our luck. Even if you don't play well, you have to still try and get wins. It's a good ball to the near post there. Guardiol maybe should be able to check back a little bit faster there. Butland, sus goalkeeping from Butland, to be fair. It's hit very hard, but you would say your near post. You probably shouldn't be getting beaten that easy. Last action of the half for Crystal Palace. Can Kabori win the header? No, he can't. Kabori got out-jumped by Luke Thomas. Are you joking? Issa, are you all right?
Well, here you can see it again. It's a
I'm pretty sure you're a foot taller than him, and you're already in the space. That is poor from Issa Kabore. He's actually jumping. Luke Thomas doesn't even jump and beats him to the header. We had rode our luck. Probably Palace deserved to get something. So 2-1 going in to the second half isn't much of a surprise. We're going to bring off Benjamin Sesko here for Wilf Zaha. Just because I want to keep, obviously, some fitness on Sesko for the second leg against Freiburg. Gelhart will also at some point have to come off in this half.
Kabore
finds Zaharri inside. I don't know if Anna Suari is going to be able to do anything with that. Oh, wait, what? I don't even... I think Sam McCallum took the shot. I don't know why Anna Suari is celebrating there. Because McCallum took the shot. It deflected in through the legs of Morata, I think. For some reason, Anna Suari is taking it himself to celebrate. Good run from Anna Suari. It's a very tight angle, so couldn't really do much. Sam McCallum takes the shot there. Does it deflect? Yeah, it does. McCallum's shot is actually going straight back across the goal. And because of Murray, it's deflected into that near corner to make it 3-1. He absolutely annihilated me. But this time it's going to be Casper Dolberg because we can't defend for shit, apparently. Once again, defensively, we're kind of all over the place. Kabore, I don't really know where he's gone. Florencio Santos is trying to cover the place that Umar Solé is covering. I don't know why. He doesn't need to be there, but he's there, so we just have to accept it. Dolberg, they're going to try and stream forward late here. Streets going to play it out wide to Luke Thomas. Kabore back to Thomas. Solé, where have you gone? Oh my god, big save at the end there from Etienne Green. Zaha wins a header. That should about see us through. It's a tight win. We didn't, not a classic Sunderland game to be honest, but we do walk away 3-2 winners. We get very unlucky not to score another goal right at the end there with, what's his face? No goal, Murray. Oh, is this the Carter one? Yeah, Carter does very well to volley. It's actually a good save from Jack Butland there. Gets a hand to it. It was just bouncing over him, but Jack Butland pushed it onto the crossbar. We had all the possession, but all of the attacks came from them, basically. The fullbacks are both among getting recommended for their two assists. And I actually think we will give an inform. The man who hasn't had many this season, Sam McCallum, going to get himself an inform on that left-back spot. Congratulations, captain. So we will open up a four-point gap over Chelsea. Chelsea have actually also played an extra game over us, so we should have even more of a gap over them if we win our game after this as well. So that is nice. We are getting closer to looking like we're going to secure a top four spot. It's not certain yet. That is going to be the end of this episode, though, however. We will start next episode off with another game against Freiburg to finish off the first leg. We'll also have Leeds and Burnley. We're getting towards the end of the season. Obviously, if we keep advancing in the cup, we'll have a couple more matches, but we're moving forward, so not bad from us. Definitely not bad. But that's going to be the end of this episode. Like I said, please like, subscribe, turn on the notification bell to get notified when the next episode is available to you, and I hope to see you in it. Peace.